The aim of this presentation is to investigate audiovisual vast narratives according to a new theoretical perspective named narrative ecosystem, a paradigm that encompasses cross-disciplinary perspective on TV series studies and other similar long-term narratives. Through this presentation, we would like to focus on the relevance of vast narratives in the contemporary media production, as well as to verify the possibility of predicting the life of vast narratives through a set of criteria. A vast narrative is an evolution of a story. That is to say, an ongoing and intricately developed storyline with many characters and multiple settings. In the contemporary media environment, a vast narrative may often coincide with popular literature, comics, MMORPG, and TV serials narratives. Contemporary TV series are no longer textual objects. They are instead the result of an ecosystemic design where a general model is developed in advance as an evolutionary system with high degree of consistency among all its components. We therefore move from the idea of text to that of narrative ecosystem. EI systems that bear a specific set of characteristics. That is an example of world building, a system, a series. This is a Heroes series. This is the links between the characters in a wall of evidence represented in the series. You will see the complexity of the structure of this type of objects that can be represented as a text. We have the necessity of another paradigm. So we begin to study these objects as ecosystems. Narrative ecosystems. Scusate. They are open systems inhabited by stories and characters that change through time and space. They are interconnected structures, sequel and prequel, reboot, spin-off, crossover, etc. They tend to reach and maintain balance over time as a sustained and persistent universes that last outside the space of the screen, whilst modifying according to unpredictable lines of development. They are not determined by a syntagmatic sequence of functions, but instead by elements that describe the environment, characters and relationships, letting the viewer travel the narrative universe. They They are formed by an abiotic component, the media context, and the biotic component, the narrative structure. The narrative material is a living one. It undergoes processes of competition, adaptation, change, modification, etc., while a biotic component is provided by the mediascape in which the TV series is included. The mediascape is shaped by economic and cultural structures of a specific country. According to this perspective, TV serial narratives are therefore open systems, comparable to natural environments, resilient in both time and space, combining and integrating narratives, characters, and users in a particular media space. In a narrative ecosystem, procedures and viewers share some practice regarding predictions of series, possible evolution. As far as the producers are concerned, top-down approach, they make prediction based on the result obtained by a TV product in terms of rating and numbers of viewers. This data provide orientation for investments and resources allocation, such as marketing campaigns, scheduling, target definitions, advertisement revenues. On the other hand, fans make provision, bottom-up approach, since they act as a community keep together by a shared interest on the life of a given TV series, as well as its duration and resilience. The narrative ecosystem model is a good way to respond to the need for a dynamic model to represent vast narratives, accounting for interaction of agents, changes, and evolutions. What is still lacking is a computational method to make prediction in the field of TV series narratives. We will approach this problem with Marta. Through this analysis, we will therefore present some theoretical basis that might be helpful in building a computational method of narrative prediction in our field of interest. We will therefore adopt an ecosystemic approach, applying ecology evolution models to the key actors of narrative ecosystems. That is to say, the characters of the story. In order to understand how narrative ecosystems evolve according to specific environment pressures, we shall first draw the notion of ecological selection. Ecological selection applies to the individuals of a population and has to do with their ability to adapt, survive, and breed. In our case, focusing on single products rather than on the overall television landscape, we shall apply this notion to the characters of a narrative ecosystem. While in natural ecosystems, the environment exerts selection over population, in the case of TV series, it is the production team that forces adaptation between a TV show and its audience through the modification of the narrative according to the tastes and demands of the audience in order to maximize ratings and revenues. An ecological niche, ecological niches exert the selection pressure that push populations in various directions. One species could give rise to diversity within the same population. In particular, accounting for directional changes of a specific trait, natural selection can be classified in three major categories: stabilizing, directional, and diversifying selection. We are applying these same categories to the distribution of characters of serial narratives, focusing on the way producers select them. Producers can insert new characters, exclude or modify the role of old ones in order to improve the series' performance and profitability. We observe that these patterns of selection in TV series are based on the three selection models detected in natural ecosystem. The first, stabilizing selection. Diversity decreases and the population tend to stabilize on a particular trait value, the stronger one. Graphically, we can see that the two extremes are selected against favoring the intermediated variants. We have on this line a trait. The central trait is selected and the lateral traits are softened. You can imagine the the measure of a part of an animal, the what's it called, becco. In the selection, a trait is the more adapted to the environment, so this trait is selected and the other traits are softened because they are not adapted to the environment in which the species is situated. It's okay. Allora, graphically we can see that the two extremes are selected against favoring the intermediate variants. One of the most evident cases of this selection model is the medical drama HouseMD. As the series goes on, the character of Dr. House proves to be the most appreciated by the audience. Its basic features and attitude get therefore boosted by producer, resulting in a peak of the curve that decreases the relevance of the other characters through its 8 seasons. The series go and the secondary characters were softened, and Dr. House characters is more and more important, more and more relevant in the show. And the secondary characters are softened because Dr. House has an audience, has a return by the audience. The audience appreciate Dr. House's presence. So Dr. House, the character of Dr. House has more and more, have more and more importance, and the secondary characters are softened. Hmm? On the one hand, this behavior might increase the TV series proficiency, but on the other hand, it may cause instability, ultimately decreasing the resilience of the system. A slight misalignment between the producer behavior and the audience taste can actually reduce the performance of the show. In the case of Dr. House MD, in fact, after focusing on the character of Greg House, there is, at some point, a comeback to the origins, with the reintroduction of old characters that have been removed for a while. To directional selection. Only one extreme of the trait distribution is select against, resulting in a shift of the curve's peaks to the other extreme. The phenomenon often occurs under environmental changes. We see this in the series. Similarly, in narrative ecosystems, external chains and upwells can affect the ecosystem itself, which consequently need to endure and adapt to the new environment, often selecting new strong features to focus on. An evident case comes against from the field of medical dramas. In Grey's Anatomy, we can see how this directional selection has been carried out over 10 seasons, 13 now, mainly thanks to a setting that allows to remove and introduce new characters and storylines according to internal or external needs. A decline in ratings, a defection of actors or other exceptional events. This leads to constant shift from one narrative focus to another, driving the creation and the stabilization of new peaks. These are the old characters that are the group of the new characters along 13 seasons. When the shift comes from contingent reasons, then the shift itself can be cause of a bad alignment between taste demands of the audience and the series narrative structure. See, for instance, what's happened in season 10 when actress Sandra Oh, quitting the show and therefore forcing the production to find an exit strategy for her characters, one of the most appreciated and loved by the audience. This behavior can also be adopted by producers to fix misalignment between the narrative set and the audience tests and demands, especially when the audience get modified because of changes in generation, as well as because of the rise of new trends. Third. Diversifying selection. Both the extremes are selected at the expense of intermediate values. Graphically, the result is a two-peaked curve in which the variant of the trait increases and the population is divided in two different groups. We see in series, we see in nature, we see in series. Diversifying selection can affect narrative ecosystems as well, creating two different narrative peaks inside the same universe that eventually results into the creation of a new one. This situation can give rise to spin-offs, show derived from already existing works and focusing on certain characters, on a certain character of a set of characters. Among many others, this happens in Grey's Anatomy and its spin-off Private Practice. To the true world are separated by spatial boundaries, they indeed are two different shows. Crossover are allowed and employed. This is on the right, the original show, Grey's Anatomy. On the left, we pick a character of Grey's Anatomy, and the production created a new show, Private Practice. Okay, and the two are separated. This is a phenomenon that is very similar to natural phenomenon of selection. This behavior is adopted in order to extend the commercial lifetime, maximizing revenues. There may be a downside to this practice. EA, the risk that the character taken outside from its original environment, the series, does not stimulate the same audience interest and reaction as it did in its previous context. So we have an analogical model between natural selection and narrative ecosystem selection, but is computing viable? Can we do a model of this? This is the work of Marta.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. And our aim is to find out a dynamic model that can explain and tell us about the evolution of narrative ecosystem and about series. And the model is our simplified representation of complex phenomena and are typically compact and enable us to conceptualize and communicate our object of interest. And with the modeling process, we would like to understand the basic structure and dynamics of what we are studying, that is a narrative ecosystem. And why model help us to better understand? Because they help us to organize and structure information, because clarify our reasoning, and therefore we can test hypotheses about them, because the models help us to communicate something that could be also in a complex form, because models help us to solve problems and also to, in order to act on a system for modify something in order to our purpose. And also models are useful to predict events about a real system. The characteristics that define a model are three, and they are realism, precision, and generality. Realism is the degree to which a model structure mimics the real world, and therefore, of course, a model is a good one if it mimics well the real world. precision is the accuracy of a model prediction, and we can have, for example, as we will see later, qualitative models and quantitative models. And while qualitative models give us information about the magnitude of variation and therefore give us often a number, qualitative models give us information about the direction of change. And the last property, generality, is the number of system and the situation to which the model correctly apply. And as you can understand, these three properties cannot be maximized at the same time in the same model, and therefore we have to find out a trade-off. Qualitative models give us information about the magnitude of a variation and are based on a quantitative representation of the system. Usually we use a mathematical representation, like here, where you can find the Lotka-Volterra equation that represent relation that in ecology is between two species, one that act as predator and the other one as prey. And here you can see the visualization of this dynamic. And for example, if we know that the prey, for example, baboons is at the initial times 80 species, 80 is in a number, and we know that the predator, the cheetahs, 40, we can plot the progression of these two species over time. And through the use of a quantitative model, we will know over time the exact number of each species, because we have described and we know that this equation described well the behavior. Qualitative model instead give us information about the direction of change, and this model maximizes generality and realism at the expense of precision, and are based on a visual display of the important components of an ecosystem and linkages between them. And in the quantitative model we have the equation of Lotka-Volterra, here we have the graph that represent the prey and the predator that are connected by qualitative link. And in the methodology that we will see, here we have the table of prediction that is the outcomes of our method, in which we can see the direction of change, where that means that we can see how the abundance of the species varies in response to input acting on the system. So what we want to do is to define a dynamic model that takes into account the evolution of narrative ecosystem. And in order to reach our aim, we are using a methodology called the loop analysis. Loop analysis is a qualitative model technique that uses sine diagraph to represent network of interacted variables, and was developed in the ecological and environmental field by Richard Levins. And now I will explain this methodology applied to the ecology, and then I will try to do the same, apply the methodology to narrative ecosystem and therefore to series. And if you have any question for the methodology, please ask some. In ecology, loop analysis is used to represent the main relationship among species, and therefore species are depicted as nodes in the graph, and the nodes are connected by oriented links. In general, in ecology, the oriented links represent the trophic relation, and therefore who is whom, but can also represent other fundamental ecological relations like commensalism, parasitism, or other. And the set of nodes and oriented links brings to the formation of what we call the sign digraph. Here you have an example of a really simple sign digraph where is represented again the predator-prey relationship, and you can see the predator and the prey represented by nodes and connected by link. That is only a qualitative measure. In fact, the predator has a negative effect on the prey is connected to it by a link that ends with a dot, while the prey that have a positive effect on predator is connected to it by an arrow. And therefore, we can identify links between variable in ecology by the from the ecological knowledge of the system and on the base of literature. And building a good model and a good sign digraph is really important because it helps us to understand better the functioning of the system of our interest. As I said before, we can represent all the fundamental ecological interaction like predation, parasitism, cooperation, and inhibition. But I would like to remember you that now we are talking about ecology, but with this methodology, you can model everything you want, and therefore you can use as a nodes also social variables or economical variables. And the important things is that you find out a way to connect the variable of your interest. In this way, we can construct the very simple sign digraph, our predator-prey system, but in a more functional way, we can reconstruct an entire ecosystem, like here, where I report the Black Sea ecosystem, and where we can have very basic variables at the bottom of the top chain, that is nutrient and phytoplankton, even reach the top predator as a shark and dolphins. And of course, this is a really simplification about the system, but is useful because bring together a lot of information that are usually apart, because every ecologist studies the one species or another, and so the effort to put together all the information is really important to improve our knowledge and to manage the ecosystem. Okay, the information about links are summarized in what we call the community matrices, where we can find the relation described in our sign digraph. For example, a zero in the community matrix means that there is no relationship between species, while a minus one means that the raw species, in this case the lions, has a negative effect on the column species, that in this case the gazelle. And in the same way, a plus one means that the raw species, the gazelle, has a positive effect on the column species. And building the community matrix is important because it will be the mathematical element that will be used by the loop analysis algorithm that we will see later. So during the process of building a model, you can write your sign digraph and your community matrix, and then we will go off. Input. In ecology, we often want to see how system react after a perturbation. And perturbation in loop analysis are called input, and they act on ecosystem by changing parameter change, by changing parameter in the growth rate of variable. Example of input are, because input can be either positive or negative. And an example of negative input is overfishing, that is that brings a decrease in the growth rate of a fish population, and therefore is considered a negative input. Instead, an example of positive input is eutrophication, that due, for example, to pollution, that brings to an increase of nutrient in the column water. And input are basically the main cause for which we would like to apply this model, because in what we will see, the table of prediction, we can see how the nodes of our interest react after perturbation. In every sign diagraph with n nodes, there are entry points for impact, and that means that impacts can act on every node, like from a nutrient, edible phytoplankton, and the top species. Okay. Impact propagate along the community and spread their effect on the various components in relation to the way they are connected to the entry point of the perturbation. Therefore, input may propagate within the system and have also effect on the variables that are far from the target variables, that is the one where act the perturbation.
No.
Now a perturbation is acting. Perché adesso siamo al coso che è un po' magari. Usare la TV? Sì. La TV è collegata, così intanto. To understand how impact propagate along the community, we use this, that is the loop analysis algorithm. And now we will see through an example all the elements that compose the algorithm. For example, if this is the system of our interest with the three nodes, And we would like to know how the input that act on variable y change the abundance of variable x. And as we are in a using a qualitative model, we can only know the direction of change, and therefore we would like to know if the abundance of variable x increase, decrease their quantity, or remains the same. And the as I said, the negative input act on variable y, changing its growth rate. The element that the first element of the at the numerator of the loop analysis algorithm takes into account the sign of the change affected the growth rate of variable y, and therefore is takes into account the input sign. The second factor instead takes into account the sign of the path linking y to x. And a path is defined as a series of links starting at one node and ending on another without crossing any variable twice. And here, for example, our path is it refers to the positive arrow that goes from y to x. The third element of the loop analysis algorithm is the sign, refers to the sign of the complementary feedback, where the complementary feedback is refers to the variables that are not involved in the path. And in this case, if we consider the path of our interest, it remains to consider the negative autoregulation on A. And there are a set of rules and a special case for the calculation of complementary feedback sign, but I don't want to go deeper in this stuff. And because the important thing is to know the element that compose the algorithm. And at the denominator, we have the overall feedback sign that it refers to the sign of the circuit that bonds all nodes. And the sign of the maximum feedback is given by the product of the sign of the links that are part of the circuit. And therefore, here we have the, now we have identified the element that compose the loop analysis algorithm, and therefore we have at the numerator the first one that refers to the negative input, input sign. The second one that refers to the path sign, and therefore positive, because we consider the path from y to x. And the third one that refers to the sign of the complementary feedback, and therefore to the negative autoregulation on A. And we have to multiply the sign at the numerator and divide by the sign of the overall feedback. And we have our prediction. Therefore, we know that if a negative input acts on variable y, the abundance of the variable x is expected to increase in its quantity. And all pathway of interaction and feedback that amplify or buffer the effect are identified by the loop analysis algorithm through the use of the basic elements that compose a sign digraph, and therefore path, circuit, and feedback. And the loop analysis algorithm tell us if a certain species are expected to increase, decrease their quantity, or remain the same. Response of system variables to input can be arranged in table of prediction, and signs denote variation in the abundance of the column variable when every row variable is affected by a parameter change. And that means, for example, that if a positive input act on the variable y, that on the variable that represent the prey, in this case the gazelle, we can see along the row that the predator is expected to increase its abundance, while the prey remains the same. Instead, if we consider a positive input act on the predator, we expect that that the prey decrease its quantity, instead the predator increase. Table of prediction are conventionally built for positive inputs, and for if you want to consider a negative input, you have just to invert the sign in the table of prediction. This result seems to be trivial because we are considering just a system of just two species, but are not trivial in a system that consider an whole system like here, where we consider the Black Sea ecosystem, and where we can see the prediction from, for example, from nutrient represented by variable n to top predator represented by the variable tp. And therefore, along the row, we can see how every column variable change their abundance in response to the input that affect the row variable. Yes, because there is too many paths, and sometimes only the loop analysis algorithm give an ambiguity and only a question mark. Therefore, we adopted a simulation with a simulation process that build random matrix in a number of n, where n is the number of nodes for 1,000. And we run the random matrix, and if they are accepted, inverted according to some criteria, we do an analysis of the percentage of case in which you find out a positive or negative prediction. And it's a next step after the loop analysis algorithm, because there are some cases in which there are too many paths, and so it is impossible only with the loop analysis algorithm to try to find out the prediction. So in general, every time that a model is built and predictions are made, it will be good to check the robustness of our model. And a major part of the work is to construct a database and make an analysis. In ecology, we construct a biomass trend and made an abundance trend analysis, because our purpose is to understand if there is a correspondence between statistically significant variation and model prediction. If I find the correspondence, that means that my model is a good one and describes well the behavior of my system. Instead, if I don't find a correspondence between a statistical significant test and model prediction, it means that my model is not very good, because it does not describe well the behavior of my system. And the next step is try to build an alternative model in order to find a better solution. In fact, here I report the advantages of qualitative modeling approach. That is, of course, the ability of building in a relatively easy way alternative models. In addition, they are useful because they require a few data, and as we saw, we we have to know just the sign of interaction, and so if a variable has a positive or a negative effect on the other one. And qualitative modeling techniques are useful because any type of variable and interaction can be included, as I said, and as we can consider, for example, together biological population, a group of people, and economical variables. In particular, there is a study that in Baja California, in Mexico, takes into account the effect of fishing cooperative and the system of economical variables according to the variation in the fish stock and in the fish population. And through qualitative modeling technique, we can, in this way, identify drivers of change and predict the direction of response to change. And therefore, for example, if in ecology, if we model an ecosystem, we can understand how to manage it according to our purpose, and we can see if we change the abundance or if we introduce some species, how the ecosystem may react. Okay, and the program that we use to apply loop analysis algorithm is R. And R is free and open source, and is a tool for data manipulation and modeling and computation and data visualization. And R is maintained and developed by a community, and you can find online a huge example of working code and many sources of expertise and support. Here you can find the tool and where you can download, and maybe if you have time we can do something later. And R is a great tool for anyone who works with data, so data journalists, school of data fellows, and also maybe for you, I don't know. And there are 14 reasons why R is better than Excel, and in my mind the two most important are the number 2, the automation, and the number 7, the reproducibility. And because the ability to repeat your analysis and reproduce them in the result is fundamental in the scientific approach. And even if, as for all programming languages, that there are a number of rules and a state of mind in which you have to enter when you start with the learning it, after that you learn the basic, you can find everything you want, the material that you need, and also find out a lot of support from the community that works around R. So the difficult part is to understand how the code works, and to create the code and the functioning, but after that you can do whatever you want. And this is the R interface, and where here you can develop your code. And for example, with the loop analysis, you have to enter here the community metrics of your interest, and after running the code, here you can find the output with the table of prediction. And here is just a small part of the code that applied the loop analysis algorithm, to see the elements of the programming languages. And I hope to be clear about how to apply loop analysis in ecological field, because now I would like to explain the application of this technique to the narrative ecosystem of our interest and therefore to series. We try to identify the corresponding key elements of loop analysis in the field of ecology to that of narrative ecosystem. Therefore, we consider nodes, and from an ecological point of view, we consider species or a group of species in our sign diagram, while in television in a series, we hypothesize to consider as node a group of characters or main plot line in the story. And as we will see later, for example, in medical dramas, we consider the sentimental plot, the professional plot, and the anthology plot, that means the medical cases that occurs during the episodes. For links, in ecology, we based our knowledge on observable phenomena like predation, competition, mutualism, and therefore on an evident phenomena. While in television, in a series, it's not too easy to find out a link between variables of our interest, for example, between two group of characters, and therefore, we based our links on the expert knowledge of the system, and we hypothesized some relationship that will be tested, and they can be validated or not, but we have the possibility to build alternative models. Input in ecology are represented by change in the growth rate of population and of variable, while in and finding the correspondent element in the field of narrative ecosystem is not easy. And our hypothesis is that we can consider an input the modification that increase or decrease the narrative potential, such as the plot twist. For example, in the series of Lost, the introduction of a second group of character on the island has allowed the multiplication and the possibility of a different story, and with the respect to the presence of only one group, and so that can be an input to our system that increases its potential. In the same way, we can consider also the negative input that can be defined as those variation narrative potential that tend to decrease the plot organization, such as, for example, the elimination of a character. Regarding the construction of the database, while in ecology we talk about biomass, that is the abundance and the living organism in a given space, in narrative ecosystem we talk about narrative biomass, that is the amount of narrative space of a specific variables through episode and season, and therefore is narrative biomass in terms of time and in terms of presence of the variables of our interest. Among the first application, I would like to talk briefly about the selection models that we saw before, and then I would like to go in a more detailed way to our main research project on medical dramas. Among the first attempts to apply loop analysis, there were selection model, and for example, here in stabilizing selection, considering the house series, we can build a sine diagram of only two variables, in which we consider with the variable h the character of daughter house, and which the variable c all other characters. And we hypothesize that these two subjects are competing for the space, and so that each one has a negative effect on the other one. We summarize the information about this link in the table in the community matrix, and we apply the loop analysis algorithm. And here you can see the table of prediction. And for example, if we apply a positive input on the variable h that represent house, that is possible due to the fact that the importance of this character increased due to the fact that the audience like this character. We can see that the variable C decreases the abundance while the variable H increases. And so we try to model what we saw in this graph with the analogy with the narrative ecosystem. Then our research has focused on medical dramas, and the purpose is to define a dynamic model that takes into account the evolution of this genre over time, using an applicable and interpretable tool, that is the loop analysis. The basic hypothesis is that there are three plot lines founding the medical drama genus, and the main goal is to capture the evolution over time. The three variables that we consider is the professional plot, the sentimental plot, and the anthology plot that represent the medical cases. And we hypothesize that the sentimental plot and professional plot are in competition, and therefore that each one has a negative effect on the other one. And the same situation, we hypothesize the same situation for sentimental plot and medical cases, while we hypothesize that the professional plot has a positive effect on medical cases, and medical cases has a negative effect on professional plot. The first medical drama under study is Grey's Anatomy, and the work method is essentially divided into three steps: the model construction, the database construction, and the model validation. We have defined the variable to consider, and therefore the three variables that are professional plot, sentimental plot, and anthology plot. And we have characterized in detail the variables, try to consider a wide range of relationship that can be traced back to the different plot. Also expecting potential overlapping between plot. For example, in the sentimental plot, we have the couple relation, the friendship relation, sexual relation, conflict relation, and so on. And in order to build the database, we decide to operate dividing each episode into segments. And we define segment the portion of the episode that characterized by continuity in space, time, and action. And for each segment, the analyst must assign a value from 1 to 6, And if there are there are two plots in the same segment, you have to assign a value to each one. Okay, in this phase, the analyst have to identify also and detect plot twist. That means therefore the radicals, if there occurs a radical change in the direction or expected outcomes of the plot. And the last step will be the validation of the model. And I would like to find out if there is a correspondence between the statistical test that we will apply to the trend of the narrative, of the three narrative plot, and the prediction in our table of prediction. And we are working on the creation of the database by analyzing the first 10 seasons of Grey's Anatomy, and by the end of January we will have the first results that can validate or not our model. Once the narrative model has been validated as a future perspective, it will be interesting to add other nodes, such as, for example, audience and other elements, because here, for example, where you can see the framework that Ilion Rostrom founded, we focused on what we can call the resource units, and therefore to the narrative element. But we can consider to add variable and so add nodes to our sign diagraph and consider other components of system and of our focus. For example, that is the first graph that we built, considering all the components, but then we realized that we have to come back and try to start with a really simple model and then add complexity to it. We have proposed a qualitative model as a research line for the study of narrative ecosystem, and our aim is to bridge the gap between the theory represented and discussed in the previous part of this seminar and the practice. And we believe that combining narrative ecosystem and loop analysis will be a major step in the field of serial production studies.